Welcome back. The chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Mark Milley, says the next Pearl Harbor could happen in space. The Space Force now leads the effort against anti-satellite capabilities from U.S. adversaries. Bradley Bowman, senior director for the Center on Military and Political Power at the Foundation of the Defense of Democracies, and writing on the FDD website. Bradley, welcome. Thanks for coming on. It's good to see you again. Is this concept of a space Pearl Harbor new that General Milley is talking about, or is this something that's existed for a period of time and we maybe haven't given it the attention it deserves?
It's a great question, and the answer is clear. It is not new. You know, there was a congressionally mandated commission 20 years ago in 2001 that warned of that very thing. And unfortunately, since that time, in the last two decades, the U.S. has not taken sufficient action. And as a result, just 2 months ago, as you said, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff again sounded the same alarm. He said, we're in danger of a space Pearl Harbor.
You write in this piece something that 20 years ago would have been very juicy science fiction. You write about maneuverable Chinese or Russian killer satellites. And you write, these increasing threats to America's early warning satellites are not hyperbolic horror stories swapped by paranoid Pentagon analysts at lunch. What are some of the real world manifestations that we're seeing of these potential threats?
You know, sometimes when people like me highlight things like this, there's some folks that might want to dismiss that at all. That's just someone, you know, trying to scare people. But, you know, the National Defense Strategy that was published in 2018 said that, you know, the United States has to build a more ready and lethal force able to deploy, survive, operate, maneuver, and regenerate in all domains, not just air, land, and sea that so many of us often focus on, but also in space and cyberspace. And, you know, this threat of a space Pearl Harbor from a China or Russia is not new. It's been coming for a long time. And that's kind of what makes it worse. You know, back in 2007, right, China conducted a ballistic missile exercise against a satellite and successfully destroyed it. Apparently, Beijing was not concerned about creating hundreds or thousands of pieces of space debris that will be in orbit for decades, but they successfully did it. And since then, we've seen Russia developing the same capabilities. It's not just missiles being launched from the ground to take out satellites. They're also developing what's called on-orbit capabilities, the capabilities for satellites to kill other satellites. You can do that via jamming. You can do that via directed energy or lasers, a whole variety of ways. And China and Russia are moving out. You don't have to take my word for it. If you read the writings of scholars in China associated with the People's Liberation Army, they're saying the goal here is to, quote, blind and deafen the enemy. And that enemy they're talking about is us.
To that end, you write this, the Space Force should field larger satellite constellations made up of dozens or even hundreds of relatively inexpensive and disposable satellites. I key on the word disposable of that entire sentence, Brad. Am I reading it wrong?
No, it's, you know, there's a lot of hardworking, patriotic people that are trying to help secure our country, but there's also bureaucratic inertia. You know, and the previous administration stood up the Space Force, it stood up Space Command. And what we don't need is these new institutions to kind of make the same mistakes, sadly, that we've seen too often from some of the other services where we have acquisition programs that take forever and go way over budget. They promise to be agile and streamlined. But the key task for the Space Force, as I see it, and for Space Command, is to make sure that we retain access to space. I mean, our adversaries understand that the U.S. military is increasingly reliant on satellites for so much of what we do, intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance. Core missions like missile defense are increasingly reliant on space. And they are not willing to kind of sit by and let America enjoy its comparative advantage in space. And that's why they've been so busy. You know, there was an anecdote a little over a year ago that your viewers might appreciate. The Russians launched a satellite. They said, hey, don't worry. You know, this is just a satellite that we're going to use to kind of do maintenance checks on our own satellites. Well, short time later, guess what happened? In a kind of a Russian nesting doll incident, that satellite gave birth to another one. And then what did that satellite do? It sidled up right next to a U.S. military's satellite and then proceeded a short time later to launch a projectile that U.S. Space Command considered a weapons test. So, you know, this is not the Gulf War of 91 here. We cannot assume that we're going to be able to assemble our forces unchallenged and then have, you know, access to GPS and everything else. And so we need the Space Force to develop more resilient infrastructure in space. And if we put all of our eggs in one or, you know, in a small number of satellites, then it's going to be that much easier for China or Russia in a Taiwan scenario, in a scenario related to the Baltics, to attack our satellites. And there, and if we have time, there's an anecdote from Iraq that really demonstrates the importance of getting this right.
We do have just a moment left, and so I want to ask you, how do we measure progressively that Space Force is not getting bogged down in some of those areas in which you suggested the other forces have, and that we find out 5 years out, 10 years out, that we are indeed bogged down and it's too late?
We have to hold them to what they say they're going to do, to be agile and streamlined and innovative. And that means really kind of revamping how we do acquisition. Early signs are positive that they're working with industry in creative new ways. So just really holding them accountable to the acquisition timelines, the milestones, fielding things quickly, trying to create that broad network of redundant capabilities that can survive assault. Working with private industry more effectively, and working with allies. You know, the first year for Space Force, they really focused on kind of collaboration within the U.S. interagency. In their second year, they're focusing on working with international partners. I'm going to watch that closely. NATO has stood up some interesting institutions. They've declared space a warfighting domain. There's great opportunities with Japan. So I think getting acquisitions right and working with our tech-savvy democratic allies to secure common interests in space will be key going forward.
Brad, great to have you back. Thanks for coming on.
Thanks so much.